Morning.
Good morning.
You're invited to comment below the video. I have a pilot here doing my tech work today, so I don't have to run the camera. But you're invited to comment below the video if there are particular prayers that you'd like to lift up and have others pray about during the week. Please let us know that you're joining us online by comment. Thank you. Beginning our worship. Jesus calls us into community, restoring us to relationship.
However isolated we may feel, however complicated your things might seem, everyone matters to God and to others.
There is no one above Jesus' attention, no one beneath Jesus' compassion. Come to encounter the one whose presence brings abundant life for all.
Let us worship together.
From the least to the greatest, your word seeks us out, O God. Recognize the power of your grace, turn toward to see you reaching out in the flesh with us even now. As you are moved with compassion for the grieving, we pray you would move us to mercy. As you are amazed by the trust of a powerful man, we pray you would move us to faith. As you witness the care of a community for its people, we pray you would knit us together in one body that works out for each other. Let us pray. We humbly pause in this time in the presence of our loving God to offer up all that weighs heavily upon our hearts, those things done and left undone, said and unsaid. All that which separates us from the love of God and neighbor. Living God, you come among us to help your people bring life out of death and hope out of despair. You work beyond the limits of our understanding, breaking open our categories of deserving. We confess that we often have clear ideas about who should get help and why. We admit that our imaginations are bound by the systems we continue to buy into, even after you show us a more excellent way. Our belief in our own independence is so ingrained. It's hard to live into the truth you offer, the truth of powerful community, compassion, no strings attached, of our place in the great whole. Forgive us when we think our lives, choices, words, and actions affect only ourselves, ignoring the impact that reaches beyond our intent.
Forgive us
when we hold more tightly to our rules than to your relentless thought. Forgive us when we perpetuate all the ways that blind us to opportunities for liberation. It changes the world. Even one life, one relationship, one community at a time. Children of God, never fear, for you have always lived in the mercy of your Creator. Hear the words of absolution and believe them. You are forgiven, you are made whole, you are restored to God, who graciously comes to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Holy God, you rewarded the faith of a Roman centurion who feared and trusted you. May we have the same unshakable faith in your mercy and ability to heal all that prevails in serving you. For the sake of Jesus, amen.
A reading from Psalms 119. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it. To observe your righteous ordinances, I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
According to Luke, the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After Jesus had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. A centurion there had a slave who he valued highly and who was ill and close to death. When he heard about Jesus, he sent some Jewish elders to him, asking him to come and heal his slave. When they came to Jesus, they appealed to him earnestly, saying, "He is worthy of having you to do this for him, for he loves our people, and it's he who built our synagogue for us." Jesus went with them, but when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you to come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but only speak the word, and let my servant be healed. For I also am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me. I say to one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes. And to my slave, do this, and the slave does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him. And turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, "I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith." When those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the slave in good health. Soon afterwards, he went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went with him. As he approached the gate of the town, a man had died was being carried out. It was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. And with her was a large crowd from the town. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion for her and said, "Do not weep." Then he came forward and touched the bier, and the bearer stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, rise." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized all of them, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us, and God has looked favorably upon his people." This word about him spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding country. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Morning. In our Gospel reading for this morning, we read about the Roman centurion who asked Jesus to heal his servant. Luke's version of the event, the centurion himself does not come to Jesus, but sends some Jewish elders to plead his case. In the Matthew version of the event, however, the centurion himself comes to Jesus. And so while there's some variation in how the story is related, it's no doubt it's the same event. Centurions, of course, were officers in the Roman army. They would command about 100 soldiers. They would easily be recognized because they wore a distinctive helmet and armor. Most usually, they worked their way up through the ranks, so they were recognized for their courage and leadership ability. The word centurion is mentioned 24 times in the New Testament, in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and in Acts. The centurions who are mentioned are often spoke well of, which I find curious since they're commanders in what is an occupying army. The centurion was a person with authority. When they tell someone to do something, they do it. So it was somewhat out of character for the centurion to ask rather than command. And he would have had to humble himself to ask a Jew the people he occupied. He must have had stories about this Jesus from someone, and for whatever reason, had confidence in what he heard. Now, if you're a commander in an army, especially an occupying army, you can't look weak. I've had people tell me that humbling yourself makes you look weak, and no one wants to look weak. So there's always a fear that if those who don't like you find a weakness, they can exploit it. So I wondered what would drive the centurion to ask instead of command. Why would he chance looking weak? Luke's version of the story says the sick man was a highly valued slave. The Matthew version simply calls him a servant. But in the Gospel of John, John talks about Jesus healing a royal official's son. Same location, Capernaum. John never uses the word centurion in his gospel. It doesn't appear there at all. So I'm going to go out on a limb here and suggest that this is the same event. And in John's version of the story, the sick person is the royal official's son. You might not risk looking weak to heal a slave or a servant, but the risk would be well worth it if it was your son. You take the risk for love. It's not to say that you wouldn't take the risk for a slave or a servant or a friend, but you certainly take the risk if it were your child. So we can speculate about who the sick person really was. But what's common to all the stories is the man's faith. The centurion said he was unworthy to have Jesus come to his house, that all Jesus had to do was give the word. And Jesus' response was, "Truly I tell you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith." The Matthew version elaborates a little bit. Jesus says, "I tell you, many will come from the east and the west and will eat with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the heirs of the kingdom will be thrown out into utter darkness, where they'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth." In other words, this man had more faith than those of you who call yourselves believers. Not necessarily what those who heard the story wanted to hear. But Jesus doesn't tell us what we want to hear. He tells us what we need to hear. And that sometimes gets him in trouble. So it begs the question, what do we put our faith in? I recently saw someone wearing a shirt that had bold letters written on it, "God, guns, and something else," whatever it was. And I've seen shirts like this when I've been out in sporting goods stores in Montana and Wyoming. I'm sure they're in stores around here too. I just haven't seen them. The shirt will say something like, "I believe in God, guns, and family," or "I believe in God, guns, and liberty." I even saw one that said, "I trust God, guns, and my dog." You can also get pictures of Jesus holding his AK-15 assault rifle. It's interesting how emotional people you can get sometimes when you start to ask them about this kind of stuff. So now I want you to know, I'm not an anti-gun person. I'm really not. But whenever I see God, guns, and whatever being equated, I think it's time to have a conversation. The centurion could brandish his sword. He had 100 soldiers under his command he could call upon to enforce his will. And you might admire him for having that kind of authority. There's something in our culture that looks up to the tough guy, you know, the rugged individual. Instead of a sword, modern-day tough guys carry their guns. He or she thinks that's what makes them strong, gives them power. But is that real power? You may recall the movie Schindler's List, which was from back in 1993. It's about Oscar Schindler, a German industrialist who saved hundreds of Jews from the Nazis by giving them jobs in his factory. And there's a scene in the movie where after a party with high-ranking officials, Schindler and Armand Goth, Armand was commandant of the concentration camp where the Jews who worked in Schindler's factory lived. They're sitting and talk. Armand is drunk. And he looks at Schindler and says, "You never get drunk. That's control. Having control is power." And Schindler asks, "Is that what they, is that why they, the Jews, fear us?" And Armand replies, "We have the power to kill. That's why they fear us." Schindler replies, "That's not power. Power is when we have every justification to kill, and we don't." Then Schindler tells a story about an emperor. A thief is brought before the emperor. The thief pleads for mercy, but knows he's going to die. He's guilty. Then the emperor pardons him. "This worthless man," Schindler says, "he lets him go. That's power. Power is that when we're able to grant life, and we do so." Jesus walks into the town of Nain. A funeral procession's in progress. It's the only son of a widow. Jesus has pity on the woman and raises her son back to life. A miracle. He restores life, not just to the son, but to the widow. That's power. In that society, women were dependent on their male relatives for support. Without the son, she might well have starved to death. So do you believe in miracles? I have to admit, this is something I struggle with. I'm a science person. I have a master's degree in engineering. So I have to wrestle with the notion that events that seem contrary to our understanding of science happen. One of the websites I find helpful is one by John Michael Talbot. He's a Roman Catholic monk from all places of offense. Right? But he has some good insights. And his comment on the story of the widow, he suggests that miracles happen all the time. We just don't see them because we don't look for it. We don't see them because, particularly for those of us who live in the West, we don't believe in miracles. Well, maybe I have a problem believing in miracles, but I can still respond to Jesus' call for life. I hope we can all do that today. I hope that it's, and I understand it's no easy cakewalk. In our confession at the beginning of the service, we said, we admit that our imaginations are bound by the systems we continue to buy into, even as you show us a more excellent way. We're slaves to our culture. The centurion felt he was unworthy to have Jesus come into home. A couple of weeks ago, when we read about Jesus calling Peter to be a disciple, Peter told Jesus to go away because he realized he was a sinful man. It may be that we also feel unworthy to answer Jesus' call, but that doesn't stop Jesus. He calls us anyhow. Jesus moves us from the crass to the wonderful, from the mundane to the miraculous, from the ordinary to the extraordinary. Jesus calls us to full life, and it's a life that gives life to others. I'll leave you today with the prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there's hatred, let me sow love. Where there's injury, pardon. Where there's doubt, faith. Where there's despair, hope. Where there's darkness, light. Where there's sadness, joy. Grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it's in giving that we receive, it's in pardoning that we're pardoned, that's in dying that we're born to eternal life. Amen. church, we confess our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
We pause humbly, offer up our prayers before God for the church, the world, and all those in need. A Roman officer recognized the power of words to create and bring about results. May we take responsibility for the words we utter and the words we create with them, choosing to speak love, mercy, and redemption for all. Healing God, hear our prayer. We live in a competitive and often ruthless world where few prosper viably and too many go without basic needs. Help us to even the balance and work for fair compensation of workers and distribution of resources so that all may thrive. Healing God. Our headstrong ways have brought destruction and disaster upon this planet we call home. Show us how our equally strong powers of innovation and creation can begin to turn around the damage we have done and bring about restoration in the natural world. Healing God, hear our prayer. You need only to say the word and we are healed. Cure our ills, whatever their cause, and strengthen us to continue serving you. Bless all those whose names we bring before you today. We pray especially for all, especially as well this day for all those we name before you, those who have no one to name them, and those who do not know Christ's name. Healing God, hear our prayer. Be with all who grieve the loss of loved ones and hold them all in your comforting arms until the day when we will all be reunited in your eternal glory. Healing God, hear our prayer. Your other petitions may be offered silently or aloud or in the comments below.
Receive our prayers and shed light on our path as we seek to walk in your ways and bring glory to you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The peace of Christ be with you all. Invited to share a sign of peace with those around you by commenting on Facebook, as well as by calling or sending messages of peace to someone. Okay. You're invited to listen to the song as our anthem for this week. You're also encouraged to continue to share your offerings to the Trinity by mailing them to the church office or by donating online via our website at www.trinitybrewsternewyork.org. We walk in the brilliance of Christ's glory, the glory of love and grace that shines upon us. May we reflect God's glory in the ways that we live daily. May these gifts today be an expression of our faith and trust in the one who gives all. When we put our trust in you, we find that we have everything we need. Accept these gifts, bless them, use them for the advancement of your earthly kingdom and the spread of your heavenly gospel. Continue with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to look in the back of your bulletin as our prayers for healing, prayers for different people in the church. Also, some notes about some of our ministries. Ash Wednesday's coming up. That's, she didn't put the date here. But you'll hear more about that in the upcoming days. I don't know exactly what we're going to be doing for that, but we'll come up with something. Offering envelopes are downstairs. Contact the church office to make arrangements to pick them up if you want to. Or you can just send your check into Trinity, and or even better, donate online. Then you don't even have to come here, all right? We'll have our Bible study again on Wednesday. And just mentioned the Brewster Emergency Shelter is continuing at Trinity, not this week, but I guess next, the following week is our week. We still need some people to provide sandwiches, and especially to sleep overnight. You know, we talk about beat God's call and granting life to people. I think the shelter is one way to grant life to people in this kind of weather. You know, this gives them a place to stay. The shelter started 15, 16 years ago when somebody died on the streets of Brewster. And up until 2015 and 2016, there was one person each of those years who died in the woods. So, you know, this is really a life-giving ministry, a ministry that makes a difference to a lot of people. This is one way we can participate in God's will. All right, so, contact my wife, Irene Germain. It's at irene6174comcast.net. Give her a call at 225-4698 if you would like to help. Okay. Anything else anybody wants to mention? We're good. Okay. Now for our blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his confidence upon you and give you peace.
Take my hand, lead me on, and let me stand on.
peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.